The following is an independently produced community access program. The viewpoints expressed are those of the community access producer and do not reflect those of Shaw Cable Systems. The program is presented in response to CRTC policy guidelines regulating community programming.
Coming to Primo's Wrestling.
Primo's? Sounds like a pizza place. Does Domino's have a wrestling federation?
They should.
Oh no.
What's wrong?
Is this lucha wrestling?
Primo's definitely Spanish, right?
Maybe it's Italian?
Will this be on Italian television?
It's me! You're a family here at Primo's Wrestling.
First of all, that's the slogan for Olive Garden. Second of all, we can't use any of this. They're going to be offended by this.
Why call yourself Primo's if you don't want me to talk Italian?
It's a technique I use that I have perfected to bring them in. They're engaged.
That's not the microphone.
In order to win wrestling, you need to cover the man.
I got chills. Mr. Cabana, that was amazing.
It's literally just won wrestling promos.
That was so awesome.
I think it's a keeper.
Next. Yeah, the next person. Okay. Next. Next. Yes.
Boom, boom. Colt Cabana. Boom, boom. Colt Cabana. Boom, boom. Colt Cabana. It's Colt Cabana. Straight out of the shop, Mr. Shake and Bake, 45. Wrestling, cause he feels alive. Great memories and good times. Said no to corporate America. Leave it up for your favorite character. You better remember when it's had been done. We'll try to front hit it.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Pro Wrestling 101. I'm your host, Kid Remington. We are back with another half-hour sit-down with a professional wrestler. And this week, we've got Davey Boy Smith Jr. Now, he's won championships everywhere he's gone, Japan, Canada, the United States, and he's also wrestled for World Wrestling Entertainment, winning the Tag Team Championships. So, always working on his craft, I present to you now, ladies and gentlemen, Davey Boy Smith Jr. Davey Boy, thanks for coming and doing the show.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Always great to be back in Winnipeg.
Nice. So, obviously, you grew up, and everyone knows your last name and the Hart family last name. Growing up in those around those families, and what was that like? What was that like as a young guy?
It was great growing up in a wrestling family, and, you know, of course, naturally, I got involved in the business myself, and, you know, ever since I was a little baby, I loved the professional wrestling business, and being surrounded by great uncles and a great grandfather and a great father as professional wrestlers, it suited, couldn't have been born into a better family for me. So it was great, always.
Did you ever think of anything else growing up, or was it just kind of through the immersion of wrestling that it was like, this is the only path in life I can take?
Well, you know, I was thinking about being a ice cream truck driver or, okay. No, just joking. No, it was always professional wrestling.
Okay, yep. Nice. Nice. So now you obviously would have trained with many people over the years. Are there any people in particular that maybe people don't think of that stick out to you as somebody that really helped you to kind of hone your craft, decide where you were going to go, and not just be another face in the Canadian wrestling crowd?
Yeah, you know, I got to give credit to my uncles, Ross and Bruce. They taught me a whole lot. My father, unfortunately, was on the road a lot, you know, with the WWE circuit and WCW, wherever else. But, you know, a couple different guys. One was Tokyo Joe up in Calgary. He was a New Japan Pro Wrestling scout. And, you know, me and TJ Wilson, we got a chance to train with him. And I started training with him when I was about 16 or 17, still in high school, and TJ had started doing tours of New Japan. And then when I was 18 and graduated from high school, I trained with Joe, and in January 2005, I did my first tour of New Japan Pro Wrestling, and he taught me so much about the wrestling business and, you know, just different ways to condition your body and such. And another guy I want to bring up, and, you know, we were talking about him earlier, was Billy Robinson. You know, I got a chance to really get to know him over the past few years, and I always went out on my own dime to Little Rock, Arkansas, to where he was residing, to learn as much as I could about submission wrestling and the sort of the UWF style that was around in Japan in the 90s. And Billy also taught me a whole lot about professional wrestling, you know, too, about you know, suplexes, submissions, you know, how to conduct, you know, business about yourself. And he was always good about advice with me with, as far as the pro wrestling business is concerned. And, you know, it was a terrible loss, and I'm glad that I was able to learn what I could from him, and you know, hopefully I can pass that on to others. That's what life's all about, and, you know, that's what the pro wrestling business has given me, and I, you know, hopefully I can pass that on to others as well, and go further with submission wrestling and martial arts and pro wrestling, and just keep working hard at it, you know?
Yeah, well said. And I mean, if there is, I got to see him wrestle way back when, and if
right
there's,
here in
if,
Winnipeg,
yes,
right?
Yeah. And if there's anything you could say like that, like obviously he's gone. If you had a chance to, and you knew he was gonna be gone, and you could tell him something, what would that be right now that just you needed him to know?
Well, I have a question to ask him. He had one submission hold he was never gonna show anybody. And he said he was gonna show me one day, and then
just never got to it. Yeah.
And no, one thing I would say is that if I were to see him now, you know, I appreciate what he showed me, and I'm sorry that I didn't apply myself more with his techniques that he showed me while he was around, but hopefully I can continue on and be able to show that, and hopefully he's watching down proud. But and I know that he would know that I'm sorry about that, and he would just say that he was glad that I wanted to learn it, but I really wanted to make him proud. And I just, you always figure that these guys are going to be around forever, and you know, they aren't, so I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I would say I'm sorry, and he would say, oh, it's all right, kid. And we'd have a beer and talk about submissions probably, but I'm sorry. And I mean that from the bottom of my heart, and I want to continue on with this legacy.
Nice, very, very well said. So I guess we're gonna go from your teachers to where you are now. Like this weekend here in Winnipeg, you're up in an independent wrestling show. And you're sort of going to be one of the big guys in the locker room, one of the big guns. Now, let's get into that a little bit quickly. Mm-hmm. Like, just maybe what's some quick advice that you could give some of the youngsters that you'll see in there, some of the newbies in wrestling? What are things that maybe they're taking for granted? Where are areas maybe they need to work a little harder?
Well, you know, unfortunately, like, a lot of these guys are not exactly rich. You know, like I had the luxury of being able to go down to train with Billy with... And I would always pay him. And I like with traveling all over the world with WWE and Japan stuff, I've accumulated like a million miles with everywhere. So I could be able to go down there and, you know, spend a week or two and learn stuff. But to these young guys, you know, take my seminars. Take seminars of guys that are of everybody, you know. You gotta have an open mind, you know. If so-and-so comes up here to do a seminar, you know, hey, you know, do it, see what you can learn off it, and go forward from there. I know Harley Race is doing some good seminars. I don't know if he still is with his conditions. New Japan came down last, about 6 months ago to Texas, and they did tryouts for guys, and they did open seminar. So, you know, just do that. I mean, YouTube.com. Oh, shoot. What's old is new. So what's old is new, and, you know, you watch older guys and
yeah.
Older techniques, and then try and bring them into your... I guess catalog of moves, and you know, try and I guess make variations of those, and you know, just have an open mind, and you know, hit the gym. I was strapped for time, but I was doing my squats, upside down push-ups, running up and down the stairs. You got to stay, conditioning is the best thing. Stay in the best shape as you can. You know, people want to look at something that's really something, you know.
That's right.
And that, you know, doesn't mean that you got to get on steroids or anything, but you got to, do I look like a normal human being? Like, walking down the street, you'd say, okay, that guy's a wrestler, or, you know.
Probably.
And you could be big like Adam Knight and still be a big brawler in there. You have to have something that the people go, oh, shoot, oh, look, he must be something. So they don't want to look at the guy and say, oh, yeah, he looks like he could be doing my taxes come April, you know, or maybe the
yes.
driving a bus. So that's, I guess, you know, hit the gym, train hard, stay dedicated to your craft, try and do the seminars, learn as much as you can.
Yeah, you want to make it seem like when you're stepping into that squared circle that's what you're there for. You're not just a guy that's somewhere else and then he just happens to be in there for 10 minutes. Okay, great.
And you know, the thing is, people think, they know that it's sports entertainment, but they want to be suspended in belief, you know what I mean? They want to be caught in that moment where they completely forget that it's, you know, that it's sports entertainment, you know, and they got to learn a lot more about presenting themselves into the ring that way and being serious. Yeah.
Why are people so hung up on, we were talking earlier before the show, and just wrestling, like, wrestling's fake or something, and why does that stop people? Like, when they go watch a movie like Captain America open this weekend, you know, like, they're going to get lost in that, they're going to enjoy it, and they don't care. They're not expecting their friend Joe to be able to jump out of an airplane and throw a shield and everything to be okay, and that's okay. Why do you think wrestling gets the bad rap?
Part of it, a lot of it is that guys aren't wrestling properly. Yeah. And that's because they don't look like they go to the gym. They look like ordinary Joe. And what they do in the ring, they're missing punches by this much in the ring. And the little kid in the crowd goes, oh, look, he missed a punch by that. And he still, you know, acted like he got hit. So part of it's that. And, you know, I think that even if people see a really good, solid professional wrestling show, they're not gonna, and I mean, well, I'm talking about really, really good guys, and they're not gonna walk away from that going, oh, that was so fake, but, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, the fans in Japan, when they go to see a New Japan show, guarantee they say, oh, what an awesome match that was, or if they're watching on Ustream, they're not gonna go and say, oh, yeah, you know, that guy looked like, you know, I could have gotten the ring and done a better job. You know, that's part of the perception of why people say, oh, it's fake or this or that. And they know it's just sports entertainment. It's been kind of exposed, obviously.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's just that people aren't doing their jobs properly and they don't look like wrestlers and they don't train, and that's it.
So far in your career, do you have any favorite matches that you've been a part of where it's kind of like, man, that's why I got into this business. This is what I wanted to do.
Yeah, you know, me and Shinsuke Nakamura, we had a great match at the last year at Ryogoku for the Intercontinental Championship. We had a really good one for the New Japan Cup too, but the IC title one was, I think, what really, you know, brought me up to a whole other level in the New Japan, New Japan Pro Wrestling's eyes. That match was awesome. I mean, me and Lance have done a lot of great tag matches with probably my favorite ones are the ones with Tenzan Kojima and against Satoshi Ishii and Shinsuke Nakamura from Korakuen Hall. And, you know, me and Tyson Kidd, we had a lot of great matches, fun ones with the Usos and DX. And, me and Tyson Kidd had a great match on Superstars. And I had I had a good match with Fit Finlay and ECW. And, you know, when me and Fit Finlay, when he returned to the Indies for a while, we had a couple fun matches. We had a really good one at Wrestle Reunion in Toronto. And he's a world-class professional, he's no BS, and he's tough, and, you know, that's what people want to be, you know, they want to see that, so. Yeah,
he makes you earn it in the ring,
yeah,
for sure.
That's right, so.
Now, so you mentioned the WWE there. Obviously, your dad, your uncles, fame in Stampede Wrestling, worldwide fame in Stampede Wrestling with what they did, and same with the WWE. What is that like to get that call and say you're going to WWE to wrestle? How was that for you?
It was cool, you know. I would say I was a lot more nervous going in first time to New Japan when I was 19,
yeah.
Just because of the age and, you know, Tokyo Joe, I mean, the way he trained me, he made me feel like I was going to go over there and shoot with the guys. Yes. I mean, Jesus. So I was so nervous. WWE, you know, it was definitely a good accomplishment, I guess. And, yeah, I mean, they had the offer, and I had nothing else better going on, so why not?
All right, you know what, something else, the wrestling fan. Mm-hmm. I'm going to break that down. You're just mentioning your trips to Japan. Reading several books, watching several tapes and videos. Obviously, I've never been over to Japan watching it. The wrestling fan in Japan is a little different than, let's say, the wrestling fan up in Canada, or the wrestling fan down in the southern United States, or down in, you know, in the Bahamas or something like that. How different are the wrestling fans, and is there one group you love to be in front of?
Yeah, you know, I mean, the fans are greater over, you know, here in Canada. The fans over in Japan are great. You know, they really treat their wrestlers with a lot of respect, and you know, it's a different kind of atmosphere to wrestle in front of, because a lot of times they're very quiet when the match is first starting and stuff like that, and then as the match builds and the excitement starts to come with the false finishes and combinations that move towards the end of the match, they really start to come and you know, they get quite excited. So I would say that when the crowd starts really heating up in Japan, that it's an awesome experience, and they really get into the submissions and the near falls and stuff like that. And you know, the fans over here in Canada are always great. You know, but I would say probably the Japanese are my favorite to wrestle in front of. Yeah.
I'm not trying to make you burn bridges or anything like that here, but I just, you know what? How is the internet? Obviously, 10 years ago, it wasn't what it is now. How has the internet changed wrestling? Has it helped it? Has it made it worse? Like, you know, is there a lot of secrets anymore? I don't know. We don't have to get too into it. Just what's your feelings on it?
You know, I think that the internet's helped it, and I think that it's maybe hurt it. But at the same time, you know, I don't know. I would say that it's probably helped it more than it's hurt it, you know. Especially nowadays with the internet, I think that it's good for independent wrestlers to get bookings. You know, yes. They can obviously use that as a reference and send it to guys. And you know, of course, you got stuff going on in WWE and guys, you know, storylines getting leaked and stuff. But you know, whatever. It is what it is. Yeah. But I would say it's helped it. You know, I mean, fans are, you know, they want to. You know, stress their opinions on the internet, and that's fine. They got opinions, and you know, it's probably helped sales of merchandise for WWE a lot.
Yeah.
And you know, it's been great for information, and thank God for YouTube. You know, with all the classic wrestling I found, you know, rare matches that my dad have found. So I'd say it's helped it. Yeah. I wouldn't say it's hurt
nice.
More than it's helped.
Well,
it.
It's a good discussion anyway. Yeah. It's something different that we're not all used to,
yes,
right?
That's right.
As far as it goes, so we have to see kind of where it's going to take us.
Yes.
So your name obviously has a lot of lineage, but you've wrestled under other names like the Black Assassin, things like that. Any preference to using your name or somebody else? Like when you're under a mask or under a different name, is there a bit of freedom there?
Yeah, I'd say I prefer the Davey Boy Smith Jr. name. It's good. I think that a lot of fans, they kind of relate me to my father, and you know, they see me and right away Davey Boy Smith Jr., even to the not so casual fan that hasn't watched it in years, and they're gonna click right away and go, oh, you know, that, you know, I haven't wrestled in a mask yet, but I wouldn't be opposed to,
okay.
I guess.
So it would just be a difference, they come and say, okay, or you have an idea, you know what, hey, I wanna put this mask on, I wanna put that on, it would be something different, right? I think it was just, yeah.
I want to put a ski mask on and wear a judo gi and do some throws and submissions and stick my tongue out.
Something different.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, awesome. So, you know what?
That would be interesting, actually.
You know what? It would
barefoot,
be totally,
too.
Totally interesting, right?
Yeah.
And who would see that coming,
yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
So, outside of the wrestling world, we're going to talk about your MMA training.
Mm-hmm.
I've been reading about you taking the MMA training. And,
yeah.
And how's that all coming along, and where do you see that going?
Yeah, you know, it's been coming along good. I you know, since unfortunately since Billy's, you know, passed away, I'm gonna get started back with training this week. And you know, I had a Japan tour I came back from, and then I had to go all the way to England and again and come back. So my body clock's been kind of off. And the Billy passing away actually kind of was saddened me and depressed me a bit. And my place in Tampa recently got broken into and completely ransacked, and which completely sucked. And I kind of just haven't been into training lately, but I'm going to start training again this week in Calgary at Champions Creed Martial Arts. And the training's coming good. I need to really train hard over the next little while, not just for my training, but for my pro wrestling in New Japan. I need to really stay focused, and I really want to take myself to a whole other level with pro wrestling in New Japan, with martial arts, and I want to start making some trips to go see Eric Paulson and Josh Barnett out in California, and get the catch back into me. I train at, like I said, I'm going to start training this week at Champions Creed in Calgary. Brian Bird there, he's a phenomenal jiu-jitsu practitioner. I mean, probably the best that I've ever rolled with on the ground. He's awesome. And, I'm a catch wrestler, but it's martial arts. And like Bruce Lee, would say that you got to take what works for you, have an open mind. And, there's some techniques in jiu-jitsu that I've used with some sweeps and different ways of passing the guard and different submissions that I've learned from Ryan or from Mateus, Andre. And, like Billy told me before, if there's a judo technique that you learn that works good for you, use it. Mm-hmm. Because, you can't always have a one set mind of how to do this way or how to do that way. I guess if you're going to be a catch wrestler and know jiu-jitsu, then that's great, And it's whatever works for you and whatever gets the win for you, basically. And I love jiu-jitsu too. It's a great art. And I might start training in a gi. I'm not sure. I've only done no gi stuff so far. I don't have a belt yet, but I've done a lot of no gi training. And I really like the art. I love Hicks and Gracie. I think he's awesome. And I want to learn more about jiu-jitsu. And it's a good way to really, get a good center of balance in your chi with your body, And after you're done, having a hard training session, you can really learn more about yourself and, what kind of person you are, and learn really what you're like on the mat. And yeah, that kind of relates to what you're like in life. And, you just train hard and your heart gets stronger, your conditioning gets better, your techniques get smoother and better. So that's what I love so much about martial arts. And hopefully I can continue to train and better myself as a martial artist and really keep catch wrestling alive and better myself as a martial artist overall.
Obviously, nutrition is important, sleep is important.
Yes.
In the gym, just as important as the gym itself.
Yes.
Now, there's this misnomer out there that all you're doing in a gym is maybe squats or maybe a bench press or maybe some curls. How much actually goes into the gym? How many days are you in there really hitting it hard, and when you're training at full speed again?
I would say about anywhere from 3 to 4 hours. I like to, my favorite time of the day to, ooh, look at that catch. My favorite time of the day to train is usually about 10 or 11. Usually when you first wake up, you might have a protein shake, go straight there, because that's when your body, once after the central nervous system wakes up, you go to the gym, go to spa, or go to do kickboxing, whatever. That's the best time to train, because that's when you're gonna have the most energy. And then come nighttime, the endorphins kind of go down a little bit. But I like to try and split it up and do one in the morning if it's strength and conditioning, and then at nighttime, whether it's wrestling or kickboxing or jiu-jitsu, or vice versa, do the martial arts in the morning and training at night. You also have to be smart about training, because you can't overtrain.
Yeah.
And I've done that. And you're just, once you get to that point, you're not getting anything out of it, and mentally you're kind of fried. And then you just got to take a few days off and, really set yourself back. And then there's days when you can spar hard, and then there's days I think that you got to really drill. Learn the technique where you're not even thinking about it. It's muscle memory. I think that's important too. And hopefully if I do something good with all this, I can have a dojo similar to what Santino Morella has in Toronto as well.
Yeah.
And teach submission wrestling, pro wrestling, jiu-jitsu, everything. It's going to be great. But that's, you know, hopefully someday.
Yeah. We got time for just a couple quick questions here.
Sure.
What is something that, you know, maybe it's like a desert island question. What is something that people that are, you know, maybe aren't in professional wrestling, what is something they need to know about it? That maybe the amount of work that goes into it, or the amount of travel, or what's something they don't see that you think they need to know that it's reality, this exists?
Yeah, well, I think that they need to know how hard the training is, especially the training I did, you know, used to endure in Calgary. You know, for the average person, they probably don't know much about pro wrestling, but I came back one time from my hand broken here, and Tokyo Joe made, this was my first practice back before going to Japan, and Tokyo Joe made me and TJ wrestle in the ring for 2.5 hours straight. No breaks, no water, no nothing. And I think that if for the average person, 2.5 hours, anything, you know, besides sitting on the computer and eating chips, or you know, even if it's 2.5 hours of just jogging, that's strength. It's hard, you know.
Yes.
And if they could understand that, appreciate what that's like. And I mean, that was, oh my God, what a workout that.
Yeah.
What a day that was. I went home and slept for 5 hours. Had some nightmares about Joe. No, that, and you know, I mean, having to wake up and make sure that all your stuff's packed for 4 a.m. because you got a 6 a.m. flight and you got an hour drive or whatever, and stuff like that, and being able to adjust to the time differences when you travel. And I mean, you know, sometimes all that stuff is harder than, you know, the 10, 15 minutes that's spent in the ring. And people need to understand and respect that as well. And, you know, I mean, the amount of time that these professional wrestlers spend away from their families and stuff like that, to entertain the fans and to support their families. And I think that people need to, that don't know anything about professional wrestling, need to understand and appreciate that. And you know what, and I don't want to, you know, I mean, stuff like that WWE actually does for Make-A-Wish and stuff like that, I think is great.
Yeah.
Despite other things, but you know, I think that's great for the kids that are sick. And you know what, I think what the professional wrestling does for the good things that it does for society like that. So I think that people, if they can understand that and see that and respect it, you know, I think that that's something that they should, you know, understand.
Okay, well said. Let me see here. Your bucket list of people you'd like, if you had your chance and you had like a list of 4 or 5 names that, man, I want to get in a ring and I'd love to just go at it with this guy. Who would some of those names be?
Oh, geez. Too many. I mean, a lot of that are passed away. You know, if it was Billy Robinson, if he was still alive, and if it was back when he was in his prime, if Jumbo Tsuruta was still alive, and if he was back in his prime, if Bret Hart was still wrestling and, you know, was back in his prime as well, my father, Dynamite Kid, he'd be one I would have loved to have wrestled with. Sayama, Satoru Sayama, Tiger Mask. I've been to his dojo in Japan and trained, and he taught me how to do the tiger suplex. You know, there's still, Hiro Hase, Chris Benoit, he was still alive, and if it was in his prime. Kenta Kobashi, Misawa, Kawada, Kamala.
Yeah. Lots of them, right?
Like, sure.
That's great, but that's what makes the sport so great.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That is the variety and the possibilities,
yeah,
that happens. When
we're all like drops of water from the rain.
That's right.
Everybody's different. Everybody has different qualities. And that's what makes great matches.
So you had one final question here. You wrestled a couple matches with your dad right at the very start of your career.
Yep.
How was that? How was that to get in the ring with?
Oh, it was awesome, man. That was right here in, I think it was Brandon in Winnipeg.
Yeah.
And that was a week before he passed away. I was glad that, you know, we got to do that. That was one thing off the bucket list. I, you know, was really glad we got to do that. And Bobby J was a great promoter. He treated us well that weekend. Glad we got to do it. Too bad, you know, he passed and we couldn't have done it more. But yeah, you know, I mean, that was, yeah, shoot. I was, would have been just sort of first starting out. I think I was doing chemistry homework on the plane ride over here, my notebook. And and I was just, I'd started training with Tokyo Joe at that time and really learning how to, the Japanese style and training and doing shows for Stampede Wrestling. So I'm really glad I got a chance to do it. And Winnipeg's kind of a special place because it, you know, was the last place my father ever wrestled. So we're going to have a great show tonight, too.
Nice. Yep. Nice. We will have a great show. And that's pretty much going to wrap up this show. I want to say, David Boy Smith Jr., thank you so much for taking a half hour with us and answering everything. You're a great, great guest.
No, thank you very much. It was great to be on here. And, you know, show should be great. Graham's a, you know, awesome promoter. Primo's is a hell of a store over there. I was playing on the pinball machine. Come on by if you're in the Winnipeg area. And follow me, DB Smith Jr. on Twitter. Thanks again.
Thank you. We'll be right back to wrap up Pro Wrestling 101.